There are two kinds of householders. One is called the Grihamedhi and the other is called the Grihastha. The objective of the Grihamedhi is sense gratification and the objective of the Grihastha is self-realization. Here the Lord is speaking about the Grihamedhi or the person who wants to remain in this material world. His activity is to enjoy material benefits by performing religious rituals for economic development and thereby ultimately satisfy the senses. He does not want anything more. Such a person works very hard throughout his life to become very rich and eat very nicely and drink. By giving some charity for pious activity, he can go to a higher planetary atmosphere and he can go to a higher planetary atmosphere in the heavenly planets in his next life. But he does not want to stop the repetition of birth and death and finish with the concomitant miserable factors of material existence. Such a person is called a Grihamedhi. A Grihastha is a person who lives with family, wife, children, and relatives, but has no attachment for them. He prefers to live in family life rather than as a mendicant or sannyasi, but his chief aim is to achieve self-realization or to come to the standard of Krishna consciousness. Here, however, Lord Kapildev is speaking about the Grihamedhis who have made their aim the materialistically prosperous life, which they achieve by sacrificial ceremonies and by charities and by good work. They are posted in good positions, and since they know that they are using up their assets of pious activities, they again and again perform activities of sense gratification. It is said by Prahlad Maharaj, Punah punascharvita charvananam. They prefer to chew the already chewed. Again and again, they experience the material pangs, even if they are rich and prosperous, but they do not want to give up this kind of life. So, in this chapter, it's a new chapter, and Lord Kapila Deva's instructions to Mother Devahuti is continuing still. So this verse begins with Kapila Uvacha, and in this chapter, as this chapter is entitled, Entanglement in Fruitive Activities. How living entities get entangled in this material world due to their performing fruitive activities, meaning actions that result in a fruit, and we are very eager to enjoy that fruit for our own sense gratification. And because of this tendency, we remain entangled in this material world. We came in this material world to enjoy our senses, and so Krishna has given us an opportunity, but we are failing to realize that this is keeping me entangled in this material world, which is full of suffering. And so the spiritual masters come, Lord Krishna comes to give us this knowledge of self-realization and to become free from the entanglement of fruitive activities. So this first verse is basically, as Prabhupada writes in the purport, that Lord Kapiladev is speaking about the Grihamedhis. Grihamedhis means a materialist whose chief aim is to enjoy the senses. A Grihamedhi lives in the center of household life and he wants only material benefits. So in the purport, Prabhupada begins with writing there are two kinds of householders. One householder is called a Grihamedhi and the other householder is called a grihastha. What is the chief difference between these two kinds of householders? Grihamedhi, his aim is sense gratification. And a grihastha, his aim is not sense gratification, but self-realization. And Prabhupada begins the purport by nicely summarizing what is a grihamedhi life. He writes four important points of what a grihamedhi life is, a life of a materialist. The first, how we identify whether one is a grihamedhi or not. So by these things we can identify which category we are in. The first symptom of a grihamedhi is that he wants to remain in the material world. At most, he may wish to elevate himself to a higher material planet, a heavenly planet, but he wants to remain in the material world. Whereas a grihastha, he wants to free himself from this material world, go back to the spiritual world, that is his goal. The second, a grihamedhi works very hard to enjoy material benefits. This morning, we were reading in the morning Mangalarti court how a grihamedhi works very hard. He gets up early morning, 4 o'clock. Actually, getting up 4 o'clock is not so easy, right? We have somehow got used to it because we are doing practicing bhakti yoga. But outside also, people who are not into Krishna consciousness are also getting up at 4 o'clock. Why? Because, like, we get up at 4 o'clock because we have a purpose. And we have strong attachment for that purpose. What is that? Devotional service. That is the purpose. We are attached to it. If we have no attachment, even we will not get up. But outside, they are getting up because they have a different kind of an attachment. That attachment is the grihamedhi attachment. Strong attachment for enjoying the senses. So grihastha also works very hard not to enjoy material benefits. He enjoys better benefits. A grihastha is more intelligent than a grihamedhi. He also wants to enjoy, material benefits are temporary. He wants to enjoy permanent benefits, spiritual benefits. That's the difference between a grihastha and a grihamedhi. The third is that a grihamedhi finally wants to satisfy his own senses. First me, then everything else. But a grihastha, his goal is to satisfy Krishna's senses. Rishikena Rishikesha Sevanam Bhaktir Uchyate. Bhakti means wants to satisfy Krishna's senses. And he knows that actually if I satisfy Krishna's senses, my senses will also automatically be satisfied. The way to satisfy my senses is not directly, but through Krishna. Like Prabhupada gives an example, if I satisfy Udareendriyanam, if my stomach is satisfied, all my senses will be satisfied. So similarly, if Krishna is satisfied, then all my senses are satisfied. How? Because my senses and are part and parcels, or the extensions of this body. So similarly, we are all extensions of Krishna. We are all part and parcels of Krishna. So that's how, both for a grihastha and a grihamedhi, the satisfaction is of the senses, but in a different way. Grihastha wants to satisfy the senses of the Lord. And the fourth symptom of a grihamedhi, somewhat they are similar, he does not want to stop the repetition of birth and death. But a grihastha, we want to stop the repetition of birth and death. That is our goal. And then further, Prabhupada said that although a grihastha lives with family, wife, children, relatives, but he has no attachment for them. So that's a very strong definition of what a grihastha life is. We may be living with a family, but we do not have attachment for them. Attachment for them meaning no material attachment for them. Any attachment, it has to be looked Krishna consciously only. And his chief aim is self-realization, nothing else. So one thing that is common to a grihastha and a grihamedhi is, we all know, we all want to enjoy. We all want to be happy. But the issue is, a grihamedhi, he doesn't know what is real happiness. He thinks that the pleasures of this material world constitute happiness, and this is everything. Actually, scriptures say there's absolutely no happiness in this material world. There is no happiness in this material world? How can that be? There must be some happiness of this material world. No. All the happiness in this material world is illusory. In fact, sometimes the absence of suffering is actually considered to be happiness. Actually, there is no absence of suffering only. It is suffering all throughout. But the suffering also comes, you know, sometimes there's big amount of suffering and sometimes there's lesser amount of suffering. So when you're relieved from a big amount of suffering and you go into a state of less amount of suffering, we think that to be happiness. And the scriptures give a very nice example. In olden days, when a criminal had to be punished during the kingly period, you know what was the punishment? The punishment that the king would administer is, he has to be submerged in the water and then lifted up again. And again submerged in the water and then lifted up again. There is a verse, Danda Jane Raja Jeno Nadi Te Chubai. Danda Jane means the Jana who has to be given Danda. Danda means punishment. What will the Raja do? Nadite Chubai. Nadite Chubai means he will submerge him in the water. Now you see, so this is happiness. What is the happiness? When he is inside the water, submerged in the water, oh, there is so much of suffering. He's almost losing his life. And when he's lifted out of the water, he feels, what a relief. But actually, the entire process of submerging him in water and lifting him out of water is actually punishment. The whole process is meant for punishment. But because he feels a little comfort while he's taken out of the water, he's raised up, he's thinking, that is happiness. In the same way, just like Danda Jane Raja Yeno Nadite Chubai, Kabhu Swarge Uthai, Kabhu Narake Dubai. This good position of material life, forget in the planet Earth, even if you're raised, if you go up to the upper planetary system and you have a life of Brahma, life of Indra, that is also like being raised from being submerged in the water. And that is happiness. No, that is not happiness. All of it is meant for punishment. That is why it is said, tasyaiva heto prayateta ko vido. One who is intelligent, what he should be aspiring after, he should not be as na labhyate yad bhramatam uparya adaha. We are all wandering in this material world from the highest planet of this material, highest planet Brahma Loka to the lowermost planet, but this is not the goal of life. Tasyaiva heta prayateta kovida. Kovida means only one who is intelligent will understand that this is not life. I'm thinking that there is happiness in the upper planets. I'm thinking there is happiness in a prosperous, opulent life, in a rich life, in a life full of material wealth and comfort. But actually, our entire stay in the material world is punishment. It's like the prison house. You go to a prison house, and the prisoners, maybe on a Sunday they have they don't have work, because every day, 6 days a week, they also work. But even Sundays, they will also have some relaxation. They'll be having some entertainment on a Sundays. Do you think that is happiness? Their whole existence is in the material world. So this is not happiness. So this is exactly the position of grihamedhis. They think there is sufficient happiness in this material world, and let me enjoy my senses to the maximum. This is not the goal of life. So we should be pursuing after spiritual life. No, this is real happiness. There may be some difficulty because I am not used to it. Like morning getting up is difficult because I am not used to it, but little austerity, little trouble. And I must know that actually even if I achieve perfection in my material life, my gain is actually zero. Because at the end of this material life, you know, when I die, all that I had acquired by my material wealth, prosperity, or position, or whatever, everything is going to become zero. But if I pursue after spiritual life, a grihastha ashrama, whatever ashram it may be, even if I'm successful 1%, that is my eternal gain. That 1% will go with me in my next life. And I will increase from that point onwards. This life, I've earned a lot. I have a big bank balance. I have a lot of degrees. I have a good position. Next life, can I come back and reclaim this? This was my position. This was my degree. This was my bank balance. That bank balance has my name. No, sir, you're finished. You're zero. So even if you become perfect in material life, it is actually a loss, complete loss. And even if I'm imperfect in my spiritual life, it is an eternal gain. Look at the wonderful equation. This is spiritual life. That is what is said. In spiritual life, we should be fearless. We should be fearless in moving forward. There may be some difficulties, there may be some troubles, but we must know that the progress that I'm making in my spiritual life is real progress. All other progress that we think are progress in the material world are all illusory progress. It'll end with the end of this body, and this life is very, very short. I must be after the real progress. And just like, and Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, Svalpam apyasya dharmasya trayate mahato bhayat. Even a small amount of progress, Svalpam apyasya dharmasya, it can protect you from the greatest danger. And the complete perfection in material life is worthless. And we have that wonderful example of Ajamila. Ajamila, to some extent, he had begun his Krishna consciousness, his devotional service. But after that, he fell down. He fell down so much, he became so degraded. There was no sin that he had not performed. But at the end of this life, he was saved. You know what abominable life Ajamila went into? How sinful he became. So sinful. But he was saved because that little bit of devotional service that he practiced helped him. So, in this human form of life, we must endeavor only for self-realization. We must know, Prabhupada writes in one place about the 84 lakh species of life. He says, if you scientifically study the 84 species of life or a transmigration in this 84 lakh yoni, jalaja nava lakshani sthavara lakshavimshati, if you scientifically study, you will realize, you will understand that this human form of life that we have achieved is a junction. And now from this junction means a crossroad. Now from this junction, you can take two paths. Either you can take the path of promotion or you can take the path of degradation. The choice is up to us. If we lead a life of sense gratification, that means we are choosing to take a path of degradation. We are choosing. You go and and path of degradation means what? An abominable body. And path of promotion means, now path of promotion also is in your hand. What kind of promotion you want? We would all love to have the best promotion, right? The highest promotion. So, as Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, Yanti devara vrata devan, pitrin yanti pitravataha, bhutani yanti bhutejya, yanti madhyajino apiman. So if you worship the demigods, or if you are urdhvam gacchanti sattvastha madhye tishthanti rajasa adoghanchanti tamasa jaganya guna vrittistha adoghanchanti tama. So promotion also, if you are in a state of, in the mode of goodness, or if you worship the devatas, you can go to the higher planetary systems. Sometimes, many people desire this. But no, our promotion is yanti madhya jino apiman. That is the highest promotion. And this kind of a promotion is possible only in the human form of life. So we should be eager. I want, this is the real promotion. And this is the reason why we have been given this human form of life. All other kinds of promotion, whether upper planetary system or lower planetary system, of course that's degradation, that is automatically available in all forms of life. So then what is the value, what is the meaning of taking this human form of life? This human form of life has been given to us to get promoted to the spiritual world. So we should be after that. But what is stopping us from getting promoted? The attachment, strong attachment for our body. Many a times, this we always come across this statement, you know, we are living in the bodily conscious of life. We are so strongly attached to our body. Once Prabhupada gave a very nice example to understand how we are attached to our body and how strong our attachment for our body is. So he was giving a class, and then he was telling, all the devotees were there. He gave this example. Suppose you are suddenly told that a great danger is going to fall upon you. Say the roof is going to fall. Maybe we have gone out somewhere and we are meeting someone, and you know, and we are all together, and somebody announces, okay, now the roof is going to fall. What will our immediate response be? We'll all want to save our body first. We'll all want to save ourselves first. We will not be willing to save our god brothers or others. Why? This shows that we have strong attachment for our body. We are very anxious to save our body first. Now, if you analyze further, so Prabhupada goes further and he doesn't analyze why we are so anxious to save our body first, not others, because of the strong attachment for the body. So why is there such a strong attachment for our body? Because I, the real person, the spirit soul, I am dwelling inside the body. That is why I want to save my body. Nobody would like to save a dead body. It's because the body is living is why I want to save the body. So that means I'm anxious to save my body because of the soul residing inside it. So actually I'm anxious to save my soul. And why am I anxious to save my soul? Because the soul is part and parcel of Krishna. And it is connected to Krishna. It loves Krishna. So actually, we all naturally love Krishna, but we have all forgotten that. We are in a state of forgetfulness, and because of being in the state of forgetfulness, we are all on this bodily platform of life trying to save ourselves, our relatives, our family members, and we think this is everything. There is nothing that exists beyond this. So this is the attachment for the body. There are many examples that Prabhupada gives, you know, to explain how we have strong attachment for the body. Another place, Prabhupada gives the example that you're living in an apartment. Now, you are residing in the apartment. Who's more important, the apartment or you? It's me. I am important. So suppose somebody is taking a lot of trouble in decorating the apartment, keeping the apartment very fit, very nicely decorated, but he is not feeding himself, he is not taking care of himself. Is that intelligence? I have to take care of myself, not the apartment. Apartment is secondary. Primary is me. So in the same way, we, without Krishna consciousness, all the activities that we do are like taking care of the body. Bhagavad bhakti heenasya jatihi shastra japas tapaha. Without Bhagavad bhakti, without Krishna consciousness, everything that you do, jati, you may have a big birth, shastra, you may be educated in Vedic knowledge also. Not the bhakti yoga Vedic knowledge, all the other Vedic knowledge. Jati, shastra, japas, tapaha. You may be chanting some mantra, you may be doing a lot of tapasya, but without Bhagavad bhakti, apranasya hi dehasya, mandanam lokaranjanam. Mandanam, mandanam means if you decorate a dead body, very nicely you decorate a dead body with ornaments. Who will consider that to be appropriate? Loka Ranjanam, some ordinary low-class people. It is actually, you know, in some community, the Shudra community, the cobbler community, it is still a fact, at least few one or two decades back it was a fact, maybe in some remote places it must still be a fact, that when a person dies, they decorate the body. So this is not very intelligent. Because, you know, the soul is important. Decoration of the dead body is like. So, this is all due to our attachment for the body. And actually, when we are trying to enjoy the senses because of strong attachment for our body, it is not that it comes without pains, without troubles. Actually, we have to take a lot of troubles and pains also in the material world to enjoy our senses. Isn't that a fact? So much of hard work. Imagine 4 o'clock, he's getting up to go travel, you know, 3 hours by train, one way, 3 hours by train, another way. So much of hard work. So much of difficulty. But still, because he's so strongly attached to the bodily concept of life, that he's willing to take that trouble because that conception of enjoying the senses is so much. And the example is given that the position of a person who is in this state that I want to enjoy my senses come what may, no matter what difficulty I face, I will enjoy my senses. This is a typical Griha Medhi. And he is compared to a very strong, you know, comparison is made. He is compared to in the scriptures as the worm in the stool. It is a very strong thing, but it's worth, you know, scriptures use these strong examples to shake us up, to wake us up to realization. A worm is so attached to staying in the stool that if you try to remove the worm from the stool, it'll be unwilling to. You separate the worm from the stool and leave it, the worm will slowly crawl back to the stool. It'll be unwilling to leave. Imagine. And the example of the hog. Hog lives in filthy conditions. And it doesn't want. You try to give the hog a better place, it won't. It wants to live in the filthy condition. This is a strong attachment for the material world. So that is why here Prabhupada ends the purport by saying that this kind of an attachment that the Griha Medhis have and they want to enjoy come what may, he's calling this as Prahlad Maharaj says, puna punas charvita charvanana, chewing the chewed. You have chewed a sugar cane. All the juice is out. You know that there is no juice inside it. Still you want to suck it. Thinking that there will be some pleasure. Actually there is no pleasure. It is all illusory. So this is not very intelligent. And Prabhupada would often tell examples like a family man who has grown up. He has experienced the whole life. He has undergone undergone all the hardships in the life. He has worked very hard. He has raised a family. He has done everything. And then you ask him, are you happy? He will say, no, I am not happy. So although he says, I am not happy, and he has experienced that unhappiness, but still, he will want the same thing to happen to his son. If you ask him, at least spare your son for Krishna consciousness, he will be unwilling to. But you are not happy. Why you want your son to go through that happiness? Yes. This is called chewing the chewed. It's all because of ignorance. So here in the verse, there's a dharman, kaman, arthan. Three words are used. Dharma, artha, kama. But moksha is not there in this verse. That's why this verse is meant for grihamedhis. They are using dharma for kama. Some ritual, some regulation, something like that for kama, not for ultimate realization. As it is said that, and in the Bhagavatam it is, dharmasya hi apavargasya nartho arthayopakalpate. Dharma should be used for apavargasya. Apavarga means entanglement. Apavarga means liberation. So people, this is typical of a grihamedhi. And this is a difference, another difference, the many differences between a grihastha and a grihamedhi. Grihamedhi is also trying to use dharma, but for entanglement, for material sense gratification. And Bhagavatam is saying, dharma should never be used for material gain, for material sense gratification. Because ultimately it's all loss. We remain entangled in this material world in different species. Dharma must be used to liberate yourself and for nothing else. So we are very fortunate that Prabhupada has given us such a wonderful arrangement for us to practice Krishna consciousness, whether it is otherwise, you know, grihastha life can be quite, you know, and householder's life can be quite risky, because there are opportunities, there are avenues for enjoyment. But if we stay in Krishna consciousness, following the rules and regulations, following the principles, then we can also become freed from the entanglement of this material world and go back to Godhead. Once Prabhupada, he was with few of his disciples. There were grihasthas, brahmacharis, everybody were there. And so he was on his morning walk, and Prabhupada asked one of his devotees, Shyam Sundar, why are the householders in Maya? Why are the householders in Maya? So this devotee didn't know what to say. Prabhupada is asking me, I'm myself in Maya. So he just, he didn't know what to reply. So Prabhupada, sensing his uneasiness, he said, that's all right. That is their position, to be in Maya. So it was a lighter moment that Prabhupada shared. But if we are not very cautious, and if we do not follow the rules and regulations, specifically attending the morning program, following all what Prabhupada has given us, reading our books properly, doing our services properly, then for the grihasthas also, it is actually not a very safe situation. But a safe arrangement has been given to us. Actually, staying outside, it's not so easy to practice Krishna consciousness. It is very difficult. Now this temple is such a wonderful opportunity that we have all got to come and be in constant touch with Krishna. So we should fully take the opportunity that is available to us, attend as much as possible the programs, attend, all what is available for us to attend in this temple. And this way we can actually get liberated. And although we are in a position like, living in with families and living with all these things, we can actually become liberated and go back to the spiritual world. So we will end here. Grantra Srimad Bhagavatam ki, Srila Prabhupada ki, Nitai Gaur Premanand.